you can fake, you can fake preaching, you can fake singing, you can fake reading the Bible, but you cannot fake prayer. As a matter of fact, had a classmate with us. You know, the things you can only grow in. Let's pray. Praise God again. My name is Del. I'm married to one wife. You allow me to remove 41 masks. I like this place. Well, you can give me, this is my club, this is not for Jesus. And I'm in black and blue. You can clap for me. And I realize, okay. Wow. That's a good thing. I have other choices, but this one, and I was going for the blue that people have, but for some reason, Brighton is the guy who could allow me to have that. Because I could look at all the potatoes. So I decided not to look, but you can as well imagine that. Me. I wanted to put a tie, but I realized, being known, that it was still talking to him, we decided to tone down a number of things. I also realized that the program is pretty the same. I like that, by the way. I love it that way. I mean, just the other day that the secretary called me, and yes, the number that's reflected on my phone, TCCU. I love that. You don't change your numbers, you don't change your programs. I like it. And God bless you. And also, if I show you the photos of our alumni son, black, red, white. May God bless you, and that is the power of continuity. Trust me, it's so powerful. It looks funny, but you come here back 10 years later and realize that more things change, more things remain the same. For that is I'll tell you in a bit why that is very important. And so our topic today, like it's been called, is knowing God. And when Osteko called me, teacher called me about the same, I was like, wow, this is an amazing talk. Just a contrast of another institution that called me on a topic, and I was telling my wife, what? University students, this is topic, as because they're complicated topics, but I love this. I'm in love with this topic, knowing God. And I'll tell you from the word go, there is nothing as fulfilling, there is nothing as peace-giving as knowing God. If you are going to give testimony, having experienced God, you realize that He is an amazing God. At times we pray because the things we want are breakthrough. And our prayer at that point is actually informed by our experience in God, i.e., our prayer at that point is powered by our faith at that particular point is powered by how much we know this God. So it's a powerful thing. And I would like to tell us to endeavor in knowing this God. And English, I believe all of you has well. Knowing is a continuous what? Present tense. It's a doing word. It's an ing word, meaning it's something we keep on doing. So I was given objectives. How do you know God? Can you be understood. The other objective was, what is the importance of knowing God? And finally, what are the roadblocks to knowing God? How can we tackle them? And my key verse is Jeremiah 9:23-24. You probably projected that, Jeremiah 9:23-24. Am I audible, the verse? This is what the word of the Lord says. This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, or the rich man boast of his riches. Just don't move on. Don't move on. You see, God is highlighting what we would ordinarily boast about. Yeah? What we would ordinarily look forward into obtaining. And so the first thing is wisdom. That's what Nasema meaning that time. So people look for wisdom. The other thing that people look for is strength. People look for strength. They want to be strong in every aspect. Even politically, they want to be very strong. They want to be rich, wealth. So those are the things ordinarily people go for. But what is God saying? 24. But let him who boasts about this, that he understands and knows who? Me. Who is that? God. God is talking. But I'm the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, righteousness on earth. For in this I delight, declares the Lord. So we see God wants us to know him. God wants us to know him. Just go to Hosea 6:6. Hosea 6:6. Again, another evidence from the Bible that God indeed wants us to know him. 6:6, the Bible reads, for I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I desire mercy, not sacrifice. And acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offering. Get me another version. Get me a different version. For I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offering. Indeed, God wants us to know him. If we read through the scriptures, just like we've highlighted now, you'll realize that indeed God wants us to know him. He wants mankind to know him. And if you're a Bible reader and have read through the journey of the children of Israel from Egypt to Canaan, you'll realize that God, in many instances, would tell and tell them, you need to know that I am Lord. You need to know him. He would do many things just to prove to them that he is God. And Jesus, just before he died on the cross, the things he mentioned, and I'll tell us about that later, but he mentioned that eternal life is comprised of knowing Jesus and knowing God. And then, talking about doctrine, it is usually very important for us as the children of God, and especially for you as the young Christians, and especially for you as the young children of God at your formative stages, i.e. when in the university or the campus. It is important for you to know the right doctrine. It is very important. You cannot be spiritually healthy when you don't have the right doctrine. How do you know that? The Bible. The Bible. When we read the Word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to interpret his word, to interpret the word of God to us, we'll be able to conceive and know what the right doctrine is. And hence, in the knowledge of God, the things or principles you need to understand. One is that God has spoken to us through his word, the Bible. We read it, we understand what God wants us to know of him.
Two, we need to understand that God is Lord. He's the king over this world. He rules everything. That's what the Bible is telling us. God is our savior. We don't have any other savior. And when I talk of God, which is another concept, is that he's triune. And salvation is one of the things that all the three persons of God are involved. God is purposing redemption. If you read the Bible, God doesn't want any one of us to perish in sin. And Jesus secured the salvation by offering himself on the cross, that he may be ransom for all of us, that we may run to him and accept him. And because of his love, I will be saved. And the Holy Spirit is at work. Just convicting us to realize our weaknesses, our inadequacies, and therefore surrender to God. And that's how salvation is completed. The other principle is godliness, which is our response to what God wants in us. You see, we respond to what God reveals to us. And that's how obedience comes in, faith. That's how we worship God, having revealed himself to us. We worship him to the depths of what we know about him. That's how prayer comes in. God having revealed himself to us in various ways, we get to pray to him, the depth of our knowledge to him. We get to submit to him. We get to praise him. We get to serve him because he is God. So having talked about that, I now want to bring it to our level, what we know best, human relationships. I know at some point in your life, maybe in groups or as individuals, you have to sit down and say, do I really know so and so? Do I really know him? We are at a stage where probably some of us are getting introduced to relationships. And when I talk of relationships, the next thing is dating. And dating can only happen in the context of planning to marry. Sindio, mulipanya romance 101. Matatisi tulipanya. So that when you have a friend that you're dating, you really want to know them. You really want to know them. At some point you just want to sit down and say, do I really know him? Does he or she really know me? And so how do we get to know each other? And you'll be surprised that for me to know her, it is our initiative for me to know her. It takes our initiative for me to know her. It is the initiative of your girlfriend, or it takes your girlfriend for you to know your girlfriend. It takes your boyfriend for you to know your boyfriend. How? We'll open up to you. You know, if it is the Bible, for example, assuming it's a mere book, the only way I'll know it is through it. That's right. If it's a car, just me to go through it and I'll get to know it. Yeah? If it's a glass, you have to know the hardness, whether it is able to sustain cold or cold temperatures. Just need to have an experience with it and you'll know. But human beings, are complex beings.
they keep secrets. And so if you want to know them, it is upon them to let you know them. They have to open up. So what is your role in that case? Just need to be available and listen as they open up themselves. As they open up their lives to you. And that's why you usually say, ladies are usually very delicate. The moment they open their secrets up to you as a man, then they become vulnerable to you. They become very vulnerable. That's why we say always to the girls, know whom you're opening up to. Because once they know you, then they're likely to do anything with you. And now to God. Has God opened up himself for us to know him? The answer is a straight yes. It is a straight yes. God wants to be known by men. So what did he do? He loved us so much. In fact, he said that I'm creating human beings in his own image. You realize that? He loved the world so much. Actually, he loved humans so much, humankind, so much, that he gave his only son to die on the cross. In fact, the word of God says, God knew us even before we were born. So it's not a matter of God knowing. He already knows you. So he's already opened up himself for us. And we need to listen to him. And you realize that when you let go, when you stop trying to know God, and you let God talk to you so that you get to know him, you realize that God indeed reveals himself to you. And you realize that you're such a small being. You're full of sin. You're such a filthy before God. What do you do at that point? You repent and surrender yourself to him. And God will make things happen in your life. You realize that you're hopeless. But God, you let God take you through and you have hope in life. I want you to imagine you're in a doctor's room with your cousin who is sick. Sick, completely sick. I.e. completely helpless. And then the doctor tells you that this condition is unsalvageable. We've done the best that we could do. Assuming it's something as simple as a disease. You present it in a very late stage. You've given the best antibiotics. So really, there's nothing much we could do. We invited your patient, so we're waiting for the labs, but as it is, this is like a very bad stage. So at that point, really, the doctor is basically telling you that this is a hopeless state. And you feel the knowledge of God. Raise your voice up and say that I know you are God. And you're going to deliver my cousin from these microbes. I want you to picture that and see how powerful it is. In the human eyes, it is hopeless. But because you have God in you, you have hope. And I keep telling people, Christians are very good people. And then, do not be vulnerable to hopelessness. Și am bucat examen, jisări. Am bucat cu examen, jisări. Cum am bucat? What will you say? Să se mai cușa venit. What will you do? It's a practical thing. What will you do? Good things. Good things. Good things. You say all things. All things. Nobody didn't say good things. All things. That's what you will say. You will just find and confirm yourself in a sense. James 4:8. God calls us to come near to Him. When we go near to Him, what happens? He comes near to us. So, what then does knowing God involve? First, we need to listen to the Word of God. And the Bible, interestingly, tells us that faith comes by hearing the Word of God. So, that is what listening to the Word of God does. It builds your faith. The second thing that we also need to know is observing the character of God. Observing the character of God, the nature of God. And this comes by us experiencing God. You trust God for one thing, you realize indeed He did it. So next time you approach His throne, you have really confidence that indeed He's going to do it. Time is limiting me, but there are very specific things that I called on God. And it was not by chance. God did it. Including ministering like this. And I told God something, and He did it. That was not by chance. It's God who does things. So since I know God can do that, next time, I just go with confidence. And again, your faith keeps building up. Then we also need to accept His invitation. I gave the example of Zacchaeus. You know, Zacchaeus was a short man, and there was a crowd. Jesus was passing, and he wanted to see Jesus. So what did he do? Finally, he asked him, Yes, come on. Come on, Zacchaeus, come on. And he was a tax collector. We all know what tax collectors do. Not then, today. Today, what we are doing, we all know what they do. If you go outside, then you realize people would like to be employed in Kenya Ports Authority, KRA, and now NHIF is also coming in. Because of the corruption within, the kickbacks, and many things. People like to go shortcuts, so they have to pay you some good money. So that is what was happening even then, like Gonzaleo, Amajana. It's not a disease that was started by Kenyans. It was then. It was there then. And so, the things we realize from that short stroll, people would refuse to come to the church, for example. People refuse to come to church. What was you, or you are an independent, or one until the younger people, or you are a hypocrite, or you realize all those are excuses. You don't go to heaven by coming to church. You don't. You don't. Jesus says is the only way to the Father. So Zacchaeus licha kwamba alikuwa na makosa mingi. Sasa kile nyumba yetu naenda kuna pesa za corruption huko. Sijui nipeleke Yesu kwingine, Yesu sijui tumalizane tu hapa. Alikubali wakati Yesu alimwita akaenda. Kufika kwake, Jesus didn't condemn him. He
ไปเล่นแต่ก็โยกโกดักขนาดนี้นี่ถ้าใครเอาตัวเลี้ยงแต่ชุกไปยุ่งกับนักการศึกษาไป and that's how his life was transformed so when we invite Jesus to our lives the things that he will cause us to do our character will change we talk of the fruit of the Holy Spirit we talk of faith and works and brethren I want us to realize that it is the presence of God in our lives that will change things that will change how we do things you look forward to coming to church just to praise God and say that Jesus you are the only one and say that God you are a mighty God you look forward to look for a prayer session just worship you God in the midst of brethren why because the presence of God is in you you'll be a godly person because God is in you you'll not try doing all these things that are crazy and be a very mechanical Christian because you want to belong no since you belong God will cause you to do that and after inviting him we get to realize that there is a lot of love that God shows us there is a lot of love that God shows us and that's how we keep up or we keep on knowing God it's also a matter of personal dealing i.e. when God opens up to us he also deals with us like I've illustrated above you know there's also knowing about God it is different from knowing God when you know about God it helps you build your trust in him and once you have trust in God that's how you get to know God it's a matter of personal involvement it involves your will your feelings it is personal that's why we keep on insisting that you need to have a personal relationship with God it has to be personal your spouse later on when you marry when you decide to marry will not cause you to go to heaven he will not or she will not however prayerful your wife will be however zealous your husband will be with the kingdom of God they will not take you to heaven it is a personal relationship the other thing is that knowing God is a matter of grace and that's why I started by saying that God loves us first it's God who knew us first now it's upon him to let us to know him and I've said he's already opened up himself it's only that God is so big in every way that our minds might not be able to comprehend him and that's why people give the story of the elephant and the blind people touch so how does the elephant look like blah blah oh touch bila ameshika mguu inatoshana hivi bila amesikia masikio inatoshana hivi bila ameshika tami inatoshana hivi we all know God in different aspects and that's why we get to fellowship so that everyone gets to tell us of their own experience of God when we make friends with God we get to love him back and Paul in Galatians 4:9 tells us that actually it's God who knows us much more than we know him
Two things that you need to know. Two very important things. Just repeating myself. We need to recognize that we lack the knowledge of God. We lack, or we don't know this God as much as we need to. And because of that inadequacy, at times we start measuring ourselves by how much we serve in the Christian Union, by how much sermons we're able to give, by the gifts that God has given us. That is not how we know God. When we pray to God, when we see God through prayer, we realize how much we know this God. My pastor, spiritual father, Reverend Vitor, keeps saying that you only know God to the extent of your prayer engagement with Him. He goes ahead to say that prayer is a statement of the readiness to change. He says that you can only preach as effective as your prayer. So prayer is very important. And why is it important? It is the only way we commune with God. So when we hear that there is prayer and fasting session on Monday, lunchtime, then we are introduced teachings. When we say that there is intercessory on Thursday, when we say that there is intercessory before the Friday and Sunday service, when we say that there was an hour of encounter after the Friday service, all those were just avenues to let you pray. There are things you can fake. You can fake preaching. You can fake singing. You can fake reading the Bible. But you cannot fake prayer. As a matter of fact, had a classmate who asked me, why? He was not a woman. He answered, you know, there are things you can only grow in. And that's prayer. And when you sincerely pray to God, when you sincerely pray to God, you realize how much you know this God. And the next pastor, I will say, in one of his encounters with God when praying, he just caught himself in a scenario whereby he was embracing God and they were just communing and saying, I've missed you so much. Oh God, I've been away from you, but I'm glad that I'm with you today. And talking about Reverend Agri, his encounter when he went to India. He said, he told me in fashion, you know, you're serving God, but now that I've come from India, I know him. He experienced another aspect of God. It's not that he didn't know God, he just didn't know the other aspect of God. And in his own words, he actually says, God resurrected him. In India. He was dead in India, but God resurrected him when his spiritual father, Reverend Vishana, prayed a prayer of resurrection. And he resurrected. You got to have more time with him than later on. He passed on. But to me, it was a testimony. Having metastasis to the brain, to the liver, to the lungs, and he was supposed to come. But Kenya. Second, we must seek the Savior. We must seek the Savior. It is what we ought to be doing all the time. You see, God, in various circumstances, all the New Testament, He says that when you seek me, you will find me. In Acts, God says that I'm not far from each one of you. To me, He's available. So we need to seek Him. I've been mentioning God reveals Himself to us. In Matthew 16:13-17, I'll just read verse 17. Then Jesus answered him, "Blessed, happy, spiritually secure, favored by God are you, Simon, son of Jonah. Because flesh and blood, mortal man did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven did." Remember Peter telling Jesus who he was? We can also know God by his revelation, i.e. Jesus can reveal to us who God is. In John 14:7, "If you had really known me, you would also have known my Father." Again in Hebrews 1:2-4, we also get it the same. The writer of Hebrews was telling us that we get to know God through Jesus. Holy Spirit, in 1 Corinthians 2:10-14, the Bible reveals to us that we can get to know the deep things of God through who? The Holy Spirit. There is no other way. It even tells us, it gives us a comparison. In 11, "For what person knows the thoughts and motives of a man except the man's spirit within him?" So, in the same measure, verse 11, "So also no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God," which is with us. So we just need to seek the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will link with our hearts. You get to know God. Must also say that knowing God is a sacrificial matter. You see, while dating, there are many things that you sacrifice. Your time, your money, and so on. It even gets worse when you get into marriage. The many things you sacrifice, vision and dreams, you sacrifice. It's even worse when you have a child. There are many things that you get to sacrifice for the sake of that relationship. And so, as it is a principle, then even the relationship between us and God is a sacrificial one. Paul gives his experience and tells the people of the Philip in Philippians 3:8-10. You realize that there are many things that Paul sacrificed. Because of time, I'm not going to that. So I'm also going to highlight some of the importance of knowing God. While those who know God have great energy for God, Daniel is one of those people. He knew who God was, and he was zealous of this God. Those who know God have great boldness for this God. Again, Daniel is such a great example. He was bold. Even when he was told he would be thrown to the den of lions, he was able to face that because he was bold, knowing who God is. The Bible tells us that as a man thinketh, so is he in Proverbs. So those who know God also have great thoughts of this God. Those who know God have great contentment in God. Because we know God, we receive grace, we receive peace. That's in 2 Peter, chapter 1, verse 2. Around 4. We get great things. In fact, the Bible says, through his divine power of knowing him, we get everything. We redeem the promises of God. We obey God. In fact, the Bible says, "You can't claim to be knowing me and you're not obeying my commands." So when we know God, we get the enablement of obeying his commands. Jesus, in John 17, 1 to 3, I have said this before, mentioned that now this is eternal life. Knowing God and Jesus is eternal life. In Isaiah 6, 6, we realize that God delights in our knowledge of him. Again, the Bible says, my people perish because of knowledge. We are the sons of God. We are the children of God. Colossians 3, 26. And since we are the children of this mighty God, we can be just endeavor to know this God. And so in conclusion, because of time, like us to respond to this. What were we meant for? Answer is to know God. We want to know God. And once we know God, we get to worship. What aim should we set ourselves in life to know this God? What is the eternal life that Jesus gives? Knowledge of God. What is the best thing in life? Bringing more joy, delight, and contentment. Knowledge of God. You see, like I said before, nothing is ever as good healing. Nothing is ever as good healing, as contenting when you know God. We all remember David. We all remember David with the swing. You can imagine, Goliath was such a seasoned fighter. David didn't have any experience. His experience were those of lions and so on. I.e. was a shepherd. He was a seasoned shepherd. That's so why he falls. Then, asking the knowledge of God, knowing what God can do. And he goes there, telling God of the things he's done in the past. And this one is a mere thing. And that's how he conquered God. Because he was confident in the knowledge of his God. I'll tell you, brethren, when we know God, when you know God, doors shall be opened for you because you know God. Time fails me, but I would have given you more illustrations on that. What of all states of God ever since man in? Gives God most pleasure. I.e., what is God delighted in most? Of all the things that we do, what delights God most is our knowledge of him. That's why all through Zote Mungu alifanya to the Israelites, all God wanted was that they may know him. You see, at some point they didn't know him. They would fail and do things against the commands of God. And God would tell them, you need to know that I am God. So we need to know God. And just on a light note, we realize even our politicians would like us to know that. They would like us to know that they are there. They're the who is who. They're the deep states. We see those things. We remember Barata, the deputy CJ. Remember her? She loved him as well. She to know people. I would imagine if President Mom Kenyatta, okay, living deputy, DP, Amekuza Hapa, into this youth and I get into her work. You may chop at my baby. And Isa, let's say the grace and I end up. He will not be pleased because you didn't acknowledge him, meaning you didn't know him, you know. And God wants to behave the same, but surely we need to know him. Is that so much for us? We need to know him. He's built the beautiful universe. By the way, if you've done apologetics, you'll realize that the exactness and the perfectness of the creation of God is unraveled. There is nothing whatsoever would happen by chance and be so perfect as the creation of God is. You all medical students, except a few of us, but I'd like to tell them, there are things in the book these people are reading that is not understood by man, even today. The physiology is unknown. There are diseases that are not known. Medical physiology. I'm to a clean answer, I think, you know. But God, move on, buddy.